Anne Bray and Harper Audio present Out of Body by Nia Davenport, performed by Karen Malina White. To all the Black girls who've ever felt like who you are isn't enough, it is. And you're amazing. Shine bright. She can no longer delay the thing she dreads. She eases a navy blue duffel bag from under the motel bed, unzips it, and stares down at its contents. The metal case on top is a small, shiny black square, something that might normally contain her charcoal pencils and blending stumps. She wants to shove the bag back under the bed and flee the motel room. She should destroy the case. She should hurl it into a river or a fire or grab a fucking hammer and bash what's inside it to pieces. But she can't, because she needs it. She needs it even more than the stack of cash buried deeper in the bag. It is time to act. She will not let guilt eat at her. So, instead of destroying the case, she snaps it open and checks that everything she needs is inside. It is. Her phone buzzes, vibrating loudly from its place on the dusty dresser. She abandons the duffel on the carpet, wipes her hands against her jeans. They always feel grimy after she touches the metal case, and grabs the phone. The dingy floral comforter reeks of cigarettes and must. She refuses to sleep beneath it. "What time are you coming over?" The text reads, so excited. Although she promised herself she will not feel guilty, her breath catches. The walls of the room seem to press inward. The girl snatches up a second duffel bag from the bed. This one contains her sketchbook and enough clothes to last her a week. She hoists it across her back, then zips the other bag and hauls it onto her right shoulder. "On my way now," she types. "Can't wait." She grabs the motel key that hangs on the hook beside the door to turn it in when she checks out. After tonight, she won't be needing the room anymore. 1. "Getting jitters?" Elsie asks me. I tear my gaze from the black metal case sitting between us on my bed.
"No,"
I lie, forcing a smile.
"Of course not."
"You better not be," she says playfully. Her light brown eyes, impeccably made up with killer mascara and festive gold eyeshadow, gleam with excitement. When she grins, the whole room gets brighter. It's this crazy, infectious thing that usually makes me want to cannonball into whatever thrill she's proposing. But what we're about to do tonight is different, bigger than our normal fun. It also means serious trouble if we get caught.
"Everything is sterile, right?"
I ask, trying to quash my nerves. She squeezes my hand.
"I wouldn't let my girl go out like that. I got you."
"Boss up," I tell myself. Tonight is a crucial friendship test, the ultimate trust fall, in honor of our 3-month friendiversary. I can't fail. She picks up the metal case and snaps it open, pulls out a small, sleek, piercing gun. I finger the earring that dangles from my right earlobe. My ears are the only things I've pierced until now.
"Wanna know a secret?"
Elsie says as she tears open an alcohol wipe packet. She slides the wet wipe over the plastic part of the gun and its metal stud holder.
"I hate needles, all types. I dread shots at the doctor. When I got this done last year, I was scared as shit too."
"Really?"
I say. Hell yeah. Only LC could say she was terrified of something and seem even cooler and more self-possessed after copping to it. She unfolds her long legs and scoots closer to me on the bed. She bumps my shoulder with hers. Our matching nape piercings will be fucking epic and bold, just like we are. I smile and swallow my nerves for good because she's right. It will look fierce, and that's the entire vibe I want. The next time Elsie says we're epic and bold, it really will apply to the pair of us, not just her, with me hopelessly trying to keep up. The decision made, a jolt of anticipation zips through me. I've never done anything this wild before. Dyeing my hair its current shade of violet is the closest I've gotten. But it's time for an evolution, and LC is the perfect wing woman. Okay, I say. So what's next? She reaches behind my head, lifts up my curly hair, and pinches my neck. Ow! I yelp. That's how we prepared folks for the sting in the shop. It shouldn't feel much worse than that. She clips a slim silver barbell into the stud holder. Her aunt owns a tattoo and piercing studio in Fairburn Heights, south of here. Elsie worked in it while staying with her last summer, so she knows what she's doing. Originally, when she brought up the idea to seal our friendship, I suggested she draw us matching bass clef tattoos. She's an incredible artist. I'm low-key jealous, and I thought it'd be perfect since we first clicked over our love of the indie rap playing in Hyped Up, our favorite coffee shop. But LC made me realize that was too basic. Tons of kids get matching friend tats. I eye the barbell, imagining how it will look on me. It'll be hidden unless I want someone to glimpse it. And then when I pull my hair up, it'll be sexy and unexpected. Daring, like me. The true me. Not the annoyingly vanilla girl I was before meeting LC. And, most important, it will match the one LC already has. We've only been friends for a short time, but I feel like I've known her my entire life. We bonded so hard, so fast. I swear, best friends at first sight is a thing. We're Betty and Veronica, without the frenemy wars. This is going to be a little cold, she says, lifting my hair again and rubbing the alcohol wipe on my skin. Creak! I bolt off the bed at the noise of the door opening. My younger sister Sophie barges into my room. I glower at her. I know I locked that door. She waves a hairpin in the air with a sly smile.
You did.
Get out, I growl, throwing a fuzzy star-shaped pillow at her head. Right now. Her eyes snag on the piercing gun LC holds and widen with interest.
Oh.
I lunge for her to physically shove her out, but the little troll dodges my grasp. I'm so dead if she tells Mom and Dad. Sophie, I start.
Y'all are getting piercings, she squeals. This is so cool. Can I get pierced too?
We are not getting anything, I tell her. She plants her hands on her hips.
Yes, we are, if I'm keeping quiet.
Soph, I snarl. The answer is no. You're a little kid. So how about you keep this secret because you love me and you don't want to see me die? And I'll give you $40, buy you that new video game you want, and do your chores for 2 weeks. She crosses her arms.
Megan, make it $60. Ghosts of Saturn, a new pink Xbox controller, my chores for a month, and unrestricted access to your manga collection you claim you don't read anymore but won't let me touch. Then it's a deal.
That's robbery. She smiles at me sweetly, her lone right dimple making her appear angelic.
If you cave about the piercing, it'll cost you zilch.
Zilch, except my soul and my moral compass because I mutilated an 11-year-old. Fine. I grip Sophie's shoulders and march my pain-in-the-ass little sister out of the room. Between the cash, the video game, and the controller, I'm out a good $200. I'll be broke until I get Christmas money next month.
Sis is ruthless, Elsie says, like it's a good trait.
I'll pay half of what baby boss bitch is extorting us for.
You don't have to do that, I mutter.
Elsie works an after-school job as a remote tutor for her spending money. I'm only giving up the rest of my birthday coins. I sit back down next to her.
Okay,
I say.
Ready.
Her hands brush the nape of my neck. I shiver as she gathers my shoulder-length curls into a high ponytail. She raises the piercing gun.
On three?
I nod.
One, two, three.
I brace for the quick prick of pain. Nothing comes.
What are you waiting for?
I toss her a teasing, confident grin over my shoulder.
Are you scared now?
She snorts, but I swear it sounds shaky.
Who, me?
Never. I'd gassed myself up before. The delay lets doubt creep back in.
You positive?
I say, suddenly hoping she'll give me an out.
All good.
Elsie grips my neck, and then, bam, a million hot fire pokers stab into my skin. I clench my teeth so my parents don't hear me shriek.
I thought you said it wouldn't hurt this bad,
I gasp. I legit wanna cry. Elsie leans forward and smooches my cheek.
You would have chickened out if I told you the truth.
A second later, I hear the snap of a picture.
You are so badass. Look,
she says, showing me her phone. I gawk at the pic of my newly pierced neck. It's a whole vibe. Boring, plain Megan? She's ghost. Gone. The best friend gods did their thing when they schemed for me and Elsie to collide at Hyped Up's pickup counter. Me thinking she swiped my secret menu frap drink changed my life.
Are you mad at me?
She asks. I look at Elsie like she sprouted tentacles.
No. It's gorgeous. I love you. You're the freaking best for suggesting it.
I throw my arms around her. She stiffens in my hug.
What's wrong?
I ask, pulling back. Her features are pinched tight when I let her go.
Nothing,
she says, but she still has the same worried or sad or sorry look.
You sure?
I say,
because even if you think you messed it up somehow, which it doesn't look like you did, I can just take it out and we can do it over. No big deal.
She's a perfectionist, so this is the only guess I have about what's upset her. She shakes her head.
It's nothing. For real. I'm fucking up the mood. We still have more friendiversary shit to do tonight. You want to call the ride share so we can head to Nathan's?
She finally smiles, but it stretches too wide, and her light brown eyes are flat. They're missing her spark. It's like staring into the empty eyes of a doll. 2.
As Elsie and I wait outside for the car, her funk seems to evaporate as fast as it arrived. She goofs around, practicing her twerk skills and knocking her hip into mine, trying to coax me to do the same. Despite my relief that her playful side is back, I snort and swat her away. Me and dancing of any.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.